Psalms chapter 1, and this was written by King David. The whole book of Psalms 1 gives us a clear distinction between the godly and the ungodly, or the righteous and the unrighteous. So the righteous are those who believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and in his finished work on the cross. They are those who are saved by the blood of Jesus and indwelt by the Holy Spirit. And they are clothed with the righteousness of Christ, not of their own righteousness, of course. And the wicked are those who are unbelievers. Those who refuse to accept the Lord Jesus Christ and who reject the gospel of salvation. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for this time, this opportunity that you have given us to study more about your words. Father, we help us to understand, and we ask the Holy Spirit to guide us and to give us wisdom and revelation on what you want us to know and to learn from your word. Father, we ask that this words will given us guidance in our daily lives. In the mighty name of Jesus, amen. The distinction between the godly, the ungodly, the believers who are clothed with the righteousness of Jesus Christ. We are the believers, have the desire for his word and for the spur for worshiping the Lord Jesus Christ. So blessed means fortunate, prosperous, and favored by God, from the Amplified Bible. Asher is the Hebrew word for blessed. It means has the idea of happiness or contentment. Asher is also the form of Hebrew word asher, to be straight or to be right. Blessed is the man who speaks of the happiness, the blessedness, the contentment in the life of the man or woman who is right or is straight with God. Means is supremely happy or fulfilled. In fact, the Hebrew word assure is actually a plural form, which implies either number of blessings or increase of blessing. What does a blessed man does not do? The book of Psalms says, blessed is the man does not walk in step with the wicked. That is from the NI version, and from the NLT, those who do not follow the advice of the wicked. This is what King David was telling us, and it gives us a good advice not to follow the advice of the wicked. The righteous and the unrighteous, the believer and the unbelievers, approach life differently. We have different way of thinking, how we behave, but the reality is this: every day we are surrounded by these kinds of people, and we cannot avoid it. We can find it in our work, in our community, in everyday living. We will always be surrounded by different kind of people. And these people may or may not influence us, and that depends upon us. Every day of our lives, we will be facing the situation that needs to be dealt with, whether a family matter, work-related, or personal matter. And it is when we need a counsel or advice of other people. And the book of Psalms, it says, do not walk in the step with the wicked. Or in NLT, do not follow the advice of the wicked. The ungodly have counsel. The ungodly have advices. And we, as the believers of Christ, we will not walk in it. We do not walk in step with the wicked. We should choose obedience, not to walk the ways of the ungodly, nor follow their advice, no matter what is happening around us, no matter how appealing those advices are. And as a believers of God, we should know how to discern if the advice is godly or ungodly. And sometimes we fail at this point. Why? Because most of the times we do not even consider if counsel is godly or ungodly. And we hear many advices to our problems, but we should discern the advices that we receive are ungodly or godly. King David advised us to delight ourselves in the Lord and meditate on his word day and night, because from his word we can get a godly counsel. Psalms 119 verse 24, God's word is always the best counselor, and we approach godly counselors like pastors, elders, teachers of the scriptures. They will always give us a godly counsel. For us, be in the right track. Let us not allow ourselves take the advice of the ungodly, because they come from their own selves. Sometimes we can get the ungodly counsels from ourselves, from our hearts, because our hearts can deceive us. We accumulated from the world. The safest place where we can get the godly counsel is from the Word of God. What does a blessed man does not do? Number two is that who does not stand in the way that sinners take? That is from the NIV. Or in NLT, it tells us who does not stand around with sinners. Sinners have their own direction. It tells us in this verse, they have their own way. They have their own direction to go. And we as believers in Christ, we should not be going in the same direction as sinners. The believers in Christ are traveling in a narrow road. Remember in the book of Matthew 7:13, tells us to enter by the narrow gate. And for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction. And there are many who go in by it. As believers of Christ, let us take the narrow, let us avoid the broad gate, because it will only lead to destruction. This is the way of the sinners, taking the broad gate. You see, in the book of Psalm 16, tells us, you lead me in the path of life. I experience absolute joy in your presence. In this verse, we could see that God has already prepared for us a path, a road that we are taking. And we should be following the path of life that God has prepared for us. Because this path of life will lead us to blessing, happiness, and eternal life. Number three, what does a blessed man does not do? Psalms chapter 1, he does not sit in the company of mockers. Who does not join in with mockers? Mockers are those who are making fun of something. They love to sit and criticize people, not only people. They criticize the Christians, the believers of Christ. And when others are putting down Christians, we will not join them. There are those who really criticize Christians. Remember that every one of us are in our way to perfection. But remember, no one is perfect. Reality, we are a work in progress. We are still on our way to perfection. But that will be achieved. We are already with the Lord. It is wrong to criticize anyone, especially the believers of Christ. Let us ask, are we still standing, sitting, or walking with the unrighteous? Those who hate God and reject Christ? Or are we taking stand for God? Are we standing up for the Lord Jesus Christ? And as a believers of Christ, what is our testimony in this world? You notice the first three first verse, it talks about the world. It talks about who are those ungodly. They do not know God, they reject Jesus Christ. The Word of God tells us we are in the world, but we are not of this world. Are we separated from the world, or are still having friendship with the world? It means, are we still sitting, standing, or walking with unrighteous? Are we doing what they do? Are we joining with those who hate God and reject Jesus Christ? Or are we taking a stand for God? Are we standing for the Lord Jesus Christ? Remember that believers of Christ are not from this world. We are sojourners, or we are strangers in this world. And another is, are we still following the counsel of the ungodly? Are you seeking a worldly advice or adopting a worldly wisdom? Are you now agreeing with the Word of God that there are still those who are very intelligent people? They mock the Bible and they mock God. So are we siding with them, or are we standing up for God? These are some of the questions we should ask ourselves. The next is that the blessed man is the man whose delight is in the law of the Lord, and who meditates on his law day and night. That delight is kepet. It means pleasure, desire, concretely valuable thing. Every one of us have some delight in our heart. Sometimes it is a very supreme pleasure. Our heart is meant, it's not meant to be a vacuum. And our hearts continue to long to be filled. And if not filled with the right thing, it will be filled with the unworthy and disappointing. And if a person is delight in something, you don't have to beg him to do it. He will voluntarily do what he delight. He desire. He is pleased to do it. Those who delight in the word of God. And because we are talking about the word of God, we can measure our delight for the word of God by how much we hunger for it. We really hunger for the word of God. You can measure. Now, is it your delight to be the word of God? Delight means, according to Webster Dictionary, take pleasure or to give keen enjoyment or to give or satisfaction to. Therefore, to delight in God's law or word is to take pleasure in the word of God. Simple word, it means we enjoy the word. It is like your favorite dessert or food. Meditate in Hebrew, haugam. It means imagine, meditate, think, study, talk, or utter. We can learn how to follow God by meditating on His word. When you meditate the word of God, spending time reading and thinking about what you have read and applying to yourself. Knowing and thinking His word is the first step in applying the word in our daily life. Then we will gradually change. And if we want to really follow God closely, we must know what to say. But if we spend time with the Lord and His word and allow Him to saturate us, we can never forget His word. In the book of James, the word of God is a mirror. Because you see, the word of God is like a mirror to us. We can see who we are. Blessed man does not just hear it and forget it. He thinks about the word of God, and we believers should also meditate on God's word. Christian meditation, our goal is to fill our mind with the word of God. So in meditation, we should digest the word of God so that we can get the nutrient of the word lying in our lives. And this way, it will bring forth much fruit in our lives. So let us not just feed on the word of God, but let us digest it day and night. And Joshua also tells us, we keep on meditating the word of God. It means filling our minds, our heart with the word of God. And when that happens, you will become successful and prosperous. When we truly rejoice or delight in the word of God, we will align ourselves with the will of God. Our desire will begin to align with His, and we will never go unfulfilled. The secret to follow His word, meditating on it day and night, so that you may be careful to do everything within it. Blessed is the man, they are like trees planted along the river bank, bearing fruit each season, their leaves never wither, and they prosper in all they do. So look at this tree, a tree planted by water or by the river, going to flourish. Beneath the surface, what is in it is connected to the source of moisture, minerals, and nutrients that needs to grow and to flourish. We are likened to that tree. We are connected to the Lord, our source of life. But this connection is so invisible. It is only you and God will know if you are really connected with the Lord. Like that of the tree, remind us of our full dependence on the Lord. It tells us that we must be connected. We must remain in God to produce much fruit. This is the only way we can produce fruits that last. Blessed is the man, tells us they are like trees planted along the river bank, bearing fruit each season. God wants us to bear fruit. God wants us to be like that tree. Years does not wither, that bear fruit in. First, when we meditate the word of God, our soul is being nourished. We are being changed inwardly. Remember in Matthew 4:4 tells us, people that live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. It means that the word of God is the bread that feeds our soul and that is strengthened our soul. And whatever we feed in our soul will eventually show in terms of decision, our responses to every situation, what is in our soul, what is in our minds, what is in our hearts, because it will show when we are faced with challenges, it will show. We will be known by our fruits in Matthew 7:6, by the fruits that they see in us. And if our soul prospers, we bring forth fruits in each season. why in Galatians 5:22 tells us, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. So you see the first prosperity inward prosperity, the fruit of the Spirit. You see that water beside the tree, it speaks about the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit is the river of living water that we are the temple of the Holy Spirit. Next is, the blessed is the man, their leaves never wither, they prosper in all they do. Wither, what does wither mean? It means dry, dead. Blessed is the man, their leaves never wither. They are those connected to the source. Who is that source? Our God. Their leaves never wither, and they prosper in all they do. A tree by a river has a continual source of water. It should also be the same to us, that we have a continual connection. We are continually connected with the source. Of course, we are connected with the source. The thing is that, do we delight ourselves in the things of God? If we do that, our lives or our lives, our service, our worship to God will never dry, because we are always refreshed by God. And the righteous man does not see any signs of death and dryness. We are continually connected to the source who are living God. If we are continually delighting in the Word of God and meditating His Word day and night, what is the result? Whatever we'll do, it will prosper. All they do, because when they say, when you say, and they prosper in all they do, this is the thing that we do, these are the thing what outwardly seen, this is outwardly, and they will be seen by people. So whatever we do, prosper. The question is, do we really delight in the Word of God? What prosperity from the Bible is that we prosper in our first, in our relationship with God. Then we prosper inwardly. Then we prosper in our everything that we do, in our relationship with other people. But of course, God tells us, put God first in everything. Meditate on His Word. You should be delighted to read His Word, to take pleasure in reading His Word. And the question is, do we really delight in the Word of God? Do we really meditate on His Word? Or is there anything that, aside from the Word of God, is there something else that we delight most?